Hi, I'm State Senator George Latimer, and welcome to Legislative Report. Here in the state capitol, it is budget season, and we're in the middle of our legislative season, so there are both financial issues and policy issues that are at stake. And one of the key policy areas that we're doing much work on is the area of education. So my guest today is a person who is experienced both in the legislative branch and the executive branch, and is now the deputy director of the Council of School Superintendents. So we're joined today by Robert Lowry. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
The perspective of school superintendents as one of the major stakeholders in the educational system, we can count parents, teachers, administrators, and school superintendents as the top administrators, school board, trustees, a lot of different players in the game. From your perspective, what do school superintendents see as the top two, three issues right now that they face in state policy on education?
You know, I would say right now, I've been involved with this policy area for over 25 years. I would say I've never seen the level of discord we have over education policy that we have right now. And a lot of that obviously concerns testing, curriculum modules, teacher evaluations, and so forth. But we need to be focused on monetary issues, financial issues right now, because the state is expected to have a budget in place by April 1. So our primary concern right now is making sure that schools get the help they need from state government.
When you look at where a school superintendent is today, the members of your organization, and they're facing a world in which there are, outside of New York City, tax cap realities. And it is conceived very difficult to attempt to pierce the cap, mm-hmm. because you have to have a 60% voter approval of your budget, mm-hmm. and you ratchet it back to zero if you don't pass it. So you're school superintendent, and you know that you're limited by the amount of money, under 2% because it's under CPI, and now you're looking at the funding issues. How has New York State been in recent years in terms of direct foundation aid and or gap elimination adjustment?
Well, you know, I think the foundation formula that was enacted in 2007, that was a major reform. It was very promising, but the state basically did the first 2 years of implementation, a four-year phase-in was anticipated, then went through a period of years in which foundation aid was frozen. In 2009-10, something called the gap elimination adjustment was born, which takes money away from districts. It's kind of a negative formula, where most formulas distribute aid to districts. This was a mechanism to take money away from districts to help balance the state budget. And what we see right now is we had two fairly healthy increases in school aid the last 2 years, but even with that, over 70% of the districts are still getting less help from the state than they were 5 years ago. Obviously, a lot of things have gone up in that period of time. I think inflation, 2.2% a year, pension costs, I think, have roughly doubled in that period of time. You know, every employer struggles with health insurance costs, so I think that's why we're seeing a lot of the stresses, the difficult choices that that superintendents and boards and voters are wrestling with right now. And the tax cap is another, you know, complication in that process.
As you look across the state, and there's 700 plus school districts around the state. In Westchester County, the folks who are watching this are spread out over about 16 districts. We do have some of the wealthier districts in the state, and we also have districts where there's growing enrollment, and not only in wealthy communities. There's growing enrollment in Rye, there's growing enrollment in Harrison, but there's also growing enrollment in Yonkers and Portchester. Mm-hmm. How much has that pressure added to funding issues on the table of a superintendent?
It's one of, you know, mix of pressures, and I think, as I say, every district has been wrestling with soaring pension costs. The Tier 6 pension reform that the governor and the legislature passed a few years ago, that will help over the long term. Some districts have the added challenge of enrollment growth. I will say that one of the things that the governor did address, you know, he would reduce the gap elimination adjustment for the year ahead by a total of $323 million. We'd say that's not nearly enough, but he does include in that a factor that would provide additional help, a bigger reduction for districts that have enrollment growth. I think that's the first time that that's been recognized, so that is a positive step.
And I would say, and as we're filming this, we are still a few weeks before the budget adoption. Nobody can be certain how it's all going to turn out. But it is a fair statement to say that on a bipartisan basis in the Senate, both Republicans and Democrats are interested in reducing the gap elimination making the adjustments to help beneficials. So we may see additional support in that area when the final budget is negotiated, mm-hmm. depending on the Assembly and the Senate. Of course, the governor has a very critical role to play in it, too. Mm-hmm. Funding, obviously, is ground zero, mm-hmm. because if you have the funding to do the things you need to do or you don't have the funding, that drives what you can do policy-wise. But you're also facing a sea change in the delivery mm-hmm. of educational services. And the buzz out in the communities is Common Core. Mm-hmm. But it's really more than Common Core, yeah. because you've had federal programs, No Child Left Behind, mm-hmm. Race to the Top. And that we've had here in the state, the annual professional performance review process, APPR. This is all gobbledygook for the person yeah. who's flipping channels. They probably keep flipping on to watch a movie or a sporting mm-hmm. event. But for those who are interested in public policy, this is really a major issue for your superintendents.
Yes. Last year, schools were really challenged to get two big state initiatives off the ground at once. Instruction aligned with the new Common Core standards, and with the consequence that students would be tested in grades 3 through 8 based on the Common Core standards. The other big thing was they were expected to negotiate, get approved by SED, the State Education Department, and get implemented new structures, systems for evaluating teachers and principals. And part of that was, part of the evaluation was required to be based on how well students did in learning the new stuff that the educators were expected to teach. So just getting those two big initiatives off the ground at once was a great challenge, caused a lot of stress. And as I said, I think compounding the stress was the idea that we're going to change how we evaluate educators and base part of that evaluation on how well they did in teaching the new stuff to kids. So that was a big challenge. And I appreciate that for most people, the only term they have to attach to whatever it is they sense is going roughly for their kids, for their schools, is Common Core. Mm-hmm. But Common Core refers to standards, general standards, directions for schools and teachers and what we want kids to be able to know and be able to do. I think among educators, generally speaking, the sense is the Common Core standards are promising the right direction. You know, not perfect, but an improvement on what we're doing. But I think a lot of the frustrations that people have arise from other issues. Again, the new teacher principal evaluation practices, the tests we use to measure how kids were learning the standards, the modules that we ask teachers to use in teaching the new standards. But again, the standards by themselves, I think most people in education say this is a promising direction.
Is it fair to say, and this would be considered a criticism, is it fair to say that the State Education Department did not solicit enough the opinions of superintendents in the development of these things?
I think there's been a lot of communication, but I think whether you're talking to superintendents or perhaps principals, teachers, a sense that while there was communication, we identified some of the problems that have arisen and, you know, those in advance, and our concerns were not addressed. You know, and, you know, there were things that a lot of superintendents would say, you know, we should have done this differently. We should have had something my organization asked for is a roadmap. Tell us what to expect. I started asking for that 2 years ago so that we don't waste effort going down a direction different from what the state has in mind, and so that we can explain to our communities, our staff, you know, the overall direction, and that would have helped, you know, give confidence and just save time and effort in implementing some of this stuff.
And all of this, obviously, Robert, comes in a climate where we've had an economic downturn mm-hmm. and a slow recovery, some places more recovery than others. But still an environment where I presume school superintendents are dealing with school boards who are dealing with an electorate that is unhappy, are still subject to the financial pressures that, mm-hmm. that you know, really hit us hard in 2008, and with electorates that aren't going to automatically approve school budgets right. unless they feel that mm-hmm. they've you know, that they've taken into account the taxpayer side of this equation. Right. Is that a fair statement?
Yes, very definitely. And I think that across the state, I think superintendents, boards, business officials, they've tried to respond to the concerns of taxpayers. You know, we did go through a period of years where we had big increases in property taxes. You know, back in 2003, schools were dealing back that year with cuts in state aid, surging pension costs. And back 2003, they proposed budgets with tax increases that average 8%. The last 5 years, similar pressures, cuts in state aid, freeze in state aid, increase in pension costs, but tax increases have averaged 2.8%. And that was even before the tax cap became law. So I think, you know, people in the districts have worked hard to try and be responsive to the concerns of taxpayers. But it is a challenge because, again, we're not getting the amount of help we used to get from the state. And some of these costs are very difficult for districts to control on their own.
I'm sure a continual dialogue in your world, and it's true in many other worlds, is that of unfunded state mandates. Mm-hmm. And while it may vary whether we're speaking to a county official mm-hmm. or a general government municipal official and other different types of things, can you sort of tick off informally what you consider to be the most significant unfunded state mandates that really need the legislature and the governor to address if we're going to give local school districts more of the leverage to deliver the product of education?
Well, you know, they're controversial, but, you know, we have a tri-borough law, and which says that, you know, if a collective bargaining agreement expires, provisions of that contract remain in effect. Employee benefits, guaranteed increases in salary tied to years of service. And the argument that you will hear superintendents and boards make is that you know, doesn't leave much incentive for collective bargaining agreement to agree to changes, say to mm-hmm. reduce health care costs. As far as we can tell, no other state has something quite like that guarantees the step increases. So that's something you'll hear a lot about. Special education and is a big concern. Mm-hmm. And again, we have rules that go beyond those most other states apply. And part of what we will say is, you know, if state government is unwilling to change those rules, then fund those rules. You know, provide adequate state aid. Don't put the pressure back on school district leaders to say, you know, you've got to make all these things work, you know, restraint in state aid, caps on local revenues, and rules that make it hard to control costs. One thing I will say is that I think that, you know, I resist calls for us to identify lists of unfunded mandates. I'd rather say, mm-hmm. what are things the state could do that would help schools reduce and control costs? And something we've talked about for a number of years is, let's work together on figuring out ways to help reduce and control health insurance costs. You know, some things, I think there's a desire to try and say, can we save money in schools without making anyone unhappy? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, if we're saving money for taxpayers, that means that money's not going into someone's pocket. You know, health insurance, at least that's not affecting school district employees and retirees. So that's the direction that we've encourage the education department. We've tried to engage in some conversations with our partners in the teachers union and others about, you know, are there some steps we could take that would help reduce and control health insurance costs for school districts?
We just have a few minutes left now, so I want to thank you very much for coming on board and giving us a little taste of some of the issues that are before the Council of School Superintendents. I assume the Council takes positions on a wide variety of public policy issues, and hoping that I can read with eyesight properly your website, we would encourage anybody from the community to go online. It's
www.nyscoss.org.
NYSCOSS?
Yes.
.org?
Yes.
And you'll be able to see what the school superintendents have highlighted. I'm State Senator George Latimer. Thank you for watching. We appreciate your time and attention. You can reach me at my district office at 934-5250 at any point in time and look forward to seeing you around. Thanks for your attention.
Yeah.